Well, hello once again. Welcome to Sunday Online from Frinton Free Church. It's great you've been able to join us. I'm Mark and this is Sally.
Shall we pray together? Father God, we thank you again for this opportunity to come together as your children, as your people, to worship you. We thank you particularly today, Lord, that we have the opportunity to pause and to spend some time focusing on the sacrifice that Jesus made for each one of us. And as we spend this time now around communion, Lord, we pray that your Spirit will draw near, that your Spirit will shine his light and reveal his truth to each one of us. Where we need to be encouraged, may he bring encouragement. Where we need to be comforted, may he bring comfort. When we need to know a way forward, may he bring revelation. We entrust ourselves to you and thank you for this time that we can be together now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. there's a few things we would like to share with you so that you know are coming up in the life of our church. And the first one is that our week of prayer starts this Monday. We do this every term here at the Free, set aside a rhythm of prayer, and it's so good to be able to meet together intensely for the week. We always meet and pray during the week at the Free, but to have a week where we're particularly focused on that is really special. And you can see the details there, they're on the screen. But let me draw your attention to the fact that you can meet online, you can meet in person at different times during the day, and also just pause in the middle of the day and say the Lord's Prayer wherever you are on your front line. It's so good to do that, just remembering that Jesus is with us wherever we are. And Wednesday night is our night of prayer, where a large number of us gather together, and that's always special for worship and prayer. So we hope to see you during the week of prayer.
Also coming up in a couple of weeks, we have our Discovering the Free course, which is our membership course for people considering joining us here at the Free. If that's you, or if you can think of someone who that might be relevant to, then ask them to contact us, and you can sign up for that on Sunday the 13th of October from 4 till 6 o'clock.
And later on in October, the 20th of October, we're going to be having some baptisms at our 10 a.m. gathering, maybe 7 o'clock as well, if people fancy it. If baptism's your next step, if you're considering being baptised, then do get in touch with us, and we can talk to you, and maybe that could happen for you on the 20th of October.
We're going to take these things that we've been talking about and bring them to God in prayer now, so let's pray. And Father, we want to begin by thanking you so much for the opportunity that we have to set aside a week, three times a year, to seek you intentionally in prayer. And we pray, Lord Jesus, that as your Spirit prompts us right across the community, across the online community, to join in prayer this week, Lord, we expect you to work. We expect you to move. We expect your kingdom to grow and for people to come to a knowledge of you. Lord, we pray that you will encourage particularly people who perhaps don't normally come to a prayer meeting, whether it's online or in person, to do so this week. Lord, we pray that you will be working and that lives will be saved as a result of this week of prayer. We thank you too, Lord, for your faithfulness to us as a church over many decades. And Lord, we thank you that you are constantly bringing new people to join our church family here. And so we pray for those who perhaps have moved here recently or are considering becoming part of our church family. We pray that you would guide them and lead them and speak to them, and that through the Discovering the Free course, they might find out and discern what your will is for them, and that we too might sense whether they are to join our church family or not. Father, we thank you for the joy of baptism. We thank you for the joy of new life in Jesus. We thank you for the numbers of people who have been baptized here and in other local churches over the last year. And we pray for those who are considering baptism later in the month of October. We pray, Lord, that you would watch over them and protect them. We pray that you'd speak to them. And Lord, if there are others for whom this is the next step, we pray that you will draw them to come forward and take this step, this public declaration that they love Jesus and want to follow him. We thank you too for the testimony that this is to the community, to families and friends who come and watch. And Lord, we trust you that you will be working to bring new life and new hope, and to bring your truth to many more people through the baptisms which will take place in a few weeks' time. Lord, we praise you for your faithfulness. We praise you for answering our prayers. And we commit these things to you now in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Think of
As you can see, we are about to share communion together. And so if you haven't got some bread, and if you haven't got some juice or some wine where you are, maybe you just want to pause and go and fetch those things so that we can join in together in this special moment where we meet with Jesus as we share communion. I'm going to use some verses from Titus chapter 3. Many of you will know that we've been reading through the New Testament as a church family in 2024. And just this week, we've read chapter 1, 2 and 3 of Titus. We've read the whole book. And in verses 3 to 7 of Titus 3, it says this. At one time, we too were foolish, disobedient, deceived and enslaved by all kinds of passions and pleasures. We lived in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another. But when the kindness and love of God our Saviour appeared, he saved us, not because of righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ, our Saviour, so that, having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life. I love those verses. I think there is so much that we can delve into, and perhaps we haven't got time now to give them full justice, but there's just a couple of things that I'd like us to focus on that I think lead us nicely into communion today. You see, these verses really show us who we were before we met Jesus and who we are now that we know Jesus. And look at what it says to start with. I'm sure you saw this in verse 3. The scene is set, isn't it? Who we were. At one time, we too were foolish, disobedient, deceived and enslaved by all kinds of passions and pleasures. We lived in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another. In other words, I guess we could summarise it and say, we were a pretty bad bunch before we came to know Jesus. We had a problem of sin that meant that our behaviour, the way we treated God, the way we treated one another, the way we treated ourselves, wasn't right. And it's interesting, isn't it, that Paul uses this phrase. He says that we were enslaved. We were enslaved. And it's an interesting word to use, isn't it? Before we know Jesus, we're slaves. That we're slaves to sin. It's interesting because I think a lot of us might look back on our lives when we were before we were saved, or even if we talk to friends who aren't saved, and people who aren't religious or don't have a faith in Jesus, they say, well, I'm free to do whatever I want. They would say, I'm not a slave. In fact, religion enslaves you, they would say. They say, actually, without that, you're not a slave. But the truth is that before we know Jesus, we are slaves. We're slaves to sin. We don't live in freedom. We think we're free, but the Bible makes it clear we're actually controlled by this condition of sin. And the reason we know that we're controlled is that actually sin eventually leads, the Bible tells us, to our death. It doesn't lead to a good place. Eventually, it will kill us. So who we were desperate. We were enslaved. But Paul goes on, doesn't he? He says, but when the kindness and love of God, our Saviour, appeared, he saved us. Something happened. We didn't have to stay slaves. Something happened. We were free and we were changed from inside out. We suddenly weren't controlled by sin anymore. We were free to be the people that God made us to be. He saved us. And we were in need of rescuing. We were in need of that help. Look at what it says here in verse 5. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ, our Saviour. We were in need of rescuing, and God did it. He reached out and he did it. And it was through his kindness and his love that he saved us and rescues us. And it tells us here how he didn't rescue us as well. It says here, he saved us not because of the righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. How good is that? You see, it's not about what you and I do that has saved us. It's not about the list of things that we've done that make us right with God. It is all about what he has done. You know, you could be the holiest and most well-behaved person that there is, but it won't be enough to save you. You know, if it was about what you and I did, we wouldn't need rescuing, would we? If it was possible to just keep doing good things and once we've done enough, then we're safe, we wouldn't need rescuing. But the point is, we did need rescuing. We couldn't rescue ourselves. And it's such good news, because if it was about the things that we did, if it was about the righteous things that you and I have done, well, how many things would we have to do? How many good deeds? How many holy moments would we have in life for that to have been enough to save us? How many old ladies would we have to help across the road to make sure we made it to heaven? And what if it was 1,000 things that we needed to do them? Then what if we did 999? Would we be discredited? Would we not be saved? It gets so tricky if it's about what you and I do. And the pressure would be immense. The weight of that would be so heavy. But God, in his kindness and his love, said, do you know what? It's not going to be on you. It's going to be on me. I will do it. I will reach out and save you. His kindness and his love. And as it says here in verse 5, his mercy. His mercy. We don't deserve it. We can't earn his love and his grace. But he still reaches out and saves us. And that is mercy. And he brings us to new life, a rebirth by the Holy Spirit. As he rescues us, he puts his Holy Spirit within us, changes us from the inside out, and he makes us brand new. And it's through Jesus that that is achieved. The Holy Spirit generously poured out through Jesus Christ, our Saviour. And it's through Jesus, through his death on the cross, through his resurrection a few days later, that we are made new, that we are brought to life, that we are set free. How good is that? As I was reading this earlier, something I noticed, I didn't realize earlier on in the week when we read it, but what we see here in Titus 3, verses 3 to 7, is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit all at work, all coordinating together to rescue us. It talks about God the Father, that is initiated by him through his kindness and his love. It talks about our rebirth, our new life through the Holy Spirit. And it talks about Jesus Christ's saving power on the cross. That's how precious you are, how precious I am to God. That Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are all at work, making sure that we don't have to stay enslaved to sin. A wonderful, wonderful thing. And that new life we see is for us today, but it's for eternal life with him as well. Look how this passage finishes. That we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life. No need to be fearful of death anymore. No need to be fearful of what's to come beyond this life. There is hope of eternal life, safe and secure in Jesus. So just consider what God has done for you. That we were once without him, that we were enslaved to an old way of life that would have led to death, that through his sheer love and kindness he moved towards you, he moved towards me, because he wanted to rescue us. That wasn't a situation he could put up with. It's unearned, undeserved grace as he reaches out and rescues you, and he rescues me, making us new and setting inside us the hope of eternal life. And Jesus, knowing all that, wants us to remember it frequently. And so he gives us this simple meal to help us to remember all of those truths, that rescuing work that he has performed. And so while he was with his disciples, we know the story on the night when he was betrayed. He's there in that upper room, and as they're eating, Jesus uses the elements, the bread and the wine that they are eating and drinking. He uses them as powerful symbols, pointing towards what he was going to do for them. I'm not sure the disciples fully grasped it. I'm not sure they fully understood all that he was saying. But years later, still part of Jesus' family, you and I know what he's done. And as we eat these and as we drink, we can remember. So in another one of his letters that we read just a few weeks ago, Paul, writing to the church in Corinth, says this: "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and he said, 'This is my body. It's given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" So I want to encourage you now to take your bread, to take a piece of it, and to eat and to remember who you once were before you knew Jesus, but who you are now through his saving work. And Jesus, we do thank you. We thank you for your sacrifice. We thank you for the pain and for the torment and the hurt, separation that you went through on the cross. Jesus, I thank you for the freedom that you have won for me on the cross. Thank you that I no longer a slave to sin, no longer a slave to fear, no longer a slave to death. But I'm part of your family, a family of love and light and love. Thank you, Jesus, for setting me free. Paul goes on to write that in the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's drink together. And so, Jesus, we choose to do that now. We proclaim your death. Your death that sets us free, that washes us clean, knowing that one day you will come again. Jesus, thank you that this blood marks that new covenant, that new promise, that it's not about the good things we do anymore. It's not about following a set of rules, but a relationship with you, our Saviour, that sets us free. That there is forgiveness in the blood of Jesus that is enough for me. And so, Jesus, we thank you here and now that we are right with you. Not because of anything we've done, but it's all because of what you've done for us. So we worship you, we praise you, we bless you, Jesus, our Saviour, who died and who rose again. Amen.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy. Your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy. Your holy name. Bless you, time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. Come on, bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Your holy name, Lord, I worship Your holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, worship Your holy name. Jesus, I will worship Your holy name. Worship Your holy name.
Thank you for joining Sally and I today for Sunday Online. We do love the fact that you tune in week on week, and let me remind you that you are so much a part of our church family. Even though you can't always be here with us, we appreciate the fact that you're watching online and we're praying for you, and we're cheering you on as you walk this life following Jesus. Let me just take a moment to remind you, particularly that it's the week of prayer coming up, and maybe have a look at those online prayer meetings that might be especially relevant for you if you're used to tuning in to Sunday online. So do check those out, and I would love to see you joining us online. And next Sunday, or next week for Sunday online, we're going to have a message from Peter Dunn. Peter works for something called Big Life, and Big Life are all over the world. Peter works here in Europe, but they're encouraging churches to be communities of disciples of Jesus who make disciples of Jesus. He's doing some incredible work and has some incredible stories to tell of what God is doing around the globe. So do tune in next week for Sunday Online and hear what Peter's got to say. God bless you. As I say, we are praying for you, and we look forward to you tuning in next Sunday.